prácticamente agotado. Hemos, en el caso de México y buena parte de América Latina, desarrollado indicadores principalmente orientados a procesos, a número de profesores, profesoras con maestría o con doctorado, a proporción de estudiantes por profesor, número de investigadoras, investigadores, etcétera, etcétera. Indicadores más orientados a los insumos, a los procesos, pero no realmente a los resultados del aprendizaje. Los propios rankings, lo platicábamos hace un rato con Alejandro Poiré, están orientados principalmente a medir temas de procesos y de investigación, no realmente los resultados del aprendizaje, no realmente las prácticas académicas dentro del aula, no realmente lo que se denomina y está afortunadamente tomando mucho auge, énfasis, el éxito estudiantil. Whatever that means, y es lo que vamos a discutir en este panel. También a nivel global, de manera reciente, y como dicen en Estados Unidos, gradually and then suddenly, está comenzando a cambiar este proceso. Cada vez, ni más ni menos, hace un par de semanas, una de las escuelas de la Universidad de Harvard renunció a los rankings, decidieron salirse de las mediciones de los rankings internacionales y enfocarse en otros indicadores. Distintas universidades a nivel global están comenzando a cuestionar de manera más aguda las metodologías. La propia OCDE, y Dirk lo puede mencionar más adelante, ha intentado cambiar estas metodologías, impulsar proyectos desde la HELO, ahora el Critical Thinking, para acercarnos más a lo que sucede en el aula de clases. Son temas, sin duda, a discusión. Si no nos vamos a orientar en los procesos, ¿cuáles son estos resultados que vale la pena medir, que vale la pena enfatizar? La OCDE ha planteado, y actualmente plantea, el tema del pensamiento crítico, tema de la creatividad, ¿sí? Pero hay otros, por ejemplo, la pluralidad del trabajo en equipo, la habilidad de aprender, y muy importante, recuperar o enfatizar de mejor manera en las universidades los valores democráticos. Hace un año, un poquito menos, el rector de la Universidad Johns Hopkins publicó un libro muy interesante que se titula ¿Qué le debemos las universidades a la democracia? En Estados Unidos, donde plantea que las universidades no estamos promoviendo de una manera tan audaz los valores democráticos, del liberalismo democrático en nuestras aulas. En fin, son temas sin duda que nos deben llamar a la reflexión y a la discusión. Con este proceso introductorio, con estas ideas como base, voy a explicar un poco la dinámica. Serán tres rondas para las y los panelistas, para que hagan un planteamiento inicial de entre cinco minutos, pueden ser seis. Afortunadamente no estamos en Expo, donde los tiempos son implacables, aquí podemos tener un poquito más de flexibilidad, y después comenzamos con la discusión, la segunda, y si nos da tiempo, tercera ronda, y algunas intervenciones que me gustaría también de parte de ustedes en el público. Bueno, voy a intercalar el orden también de acuerdo a las rondas, pero le pediría a nuestro invitado especial, Mario López, director del Centro OCDE de México y América Latina, y creo que también Iberoamérica, ya también, ¿no? Y recientemente también Iberoamérica, tienes más chamba, maestro, ¿no? Que nos pueda hacer un mensaje, un planteamiento introductorio sobre este importante tema desde la visión de la Organización para la Cooperación y Desarrollo Económicos. Adelante, Mario.
Muchas gracias, Iván. Buenas tardes ya a todas y todos, los panelistas también. Yo no soy experto en esta materia, soy el director del Centro de la OCDE para Iberoamérica, como bien lo dijo Iván, pero en el momento en que Iván me comentó la posibilidad de poder participar en este tema, yo dije, me aviento de cabeza, porque ese es la neta del planeta, ese tema es el futuro, es importantísimo para nuestros países, para el tipo de sociedades, de políticas, el tipo de progreso humano que queremos forjar. Me siento muy bien respaldado, ahora sí que literalmente, porque a mis espaldas tienen a Dirk, que, a quien saludo porque hace mucho que no veo. Hi Dirk. Y otros grandes expertos y expertas atrás de mí, así que me siento muy tranquilo para darles nada más algunos comentarios introductorios. Y bueno, las destrezas y habilidades que ustedes adquieren en las universidades se han convertido en, eso lo decíamos mucho en la OCDE y lo seguimos diciendo, la nueva divisa del siglo XXI. Así como el dólar fue y sigue siendo una de las divisas internacionales de referencia, ahora la divisa de los países son las habilidades y destrezas que sus estudiantes adquieren en las universidades. Y es que esta sustancia mágica, que son las habilidades y destrezas que ustedes están adquiriendo cotidianamente en las aulas universitarias, la puedes cambiar por un ingreso. Es una sustancia que les va a atraer beneficios, oportunidades y, si todo va bien, felicidad y bienestar en la vida. Pero imagínense que esta sustancia mágica, de repente, nos empezamos a dar cuenta de que empieza a tener problemas de cambio, que ustedes llegan con esta sustancia mágica que adquirieron en una universidad a los mercados laborales y el mercado laboral te dice, aquí no aceptamos, como American Express, aquí esa no. Y están buscando por otro lado, y acá tampoco, ¿no? Pero al mismo tiempo tenemos la paradoja que las empresas y los empleadores batallan para encontrar las habilidades y destrezas que están requiriendo en la economía digital, que están requiriendo en esta época en la que estamos enfrentando tantos desafíos y en la que los países están con problemas de crecimiento, de inclusión. Y entonces hay este desajuste entre la oferta de habilidades y destrezas, la oferta de laboral y la demanda por parte de los empleadores de este tipo de habilidades y destrezas. Cuando hay una dislocación y empieza a haber una dislocación así, nos empezamos a preguntar en organismos internacionales como la OCDE, pero seguro en muchas partes que, en donde trabajan el tema educacional, ¿qué está pasando? ¿Dónde nos está fallando? ¿Qué es tanto está cambiando? Esto es particularmente importante en países como México, en donde hay una gran expectativa de parte de los jóvenes de lo que les va a atribuir, lo que les va a dar esa capacidad, esas habilidades que les da la universidad. México y Chile son los países de la OCDE en donde hay más altas expectativas de parte de los jóvenes al terminar una carrera. Y les voy a dar un dato que me parece muy interesante. Alrededor del 26% de los trabajadores mexicanos tienen un nivel de educación superior que está sobrecalificada. Y el 31% tienen una educación superior insuficiente para su trabajo. Y luego viene la que me llamó más la atención. El 40% de los graduados terciarios, de los graduados de universidad, empleados en México, el 40% trabaja en una ocupación que no está relacionada con su área de estudio. Imagínense ustedes lo que eso le hace al entusiasmo del trabajador, lo que eso le puede hacer a la productividad, lo que eso también le puede hacer a la competitividad y a la remuneración de los trabajadores. En la OCDE nos dedicamos a ayudar a los países a mejorar sus políticas públicas en prácticamente todas las áreas de política pública, pero la educación es uno de nuestros campos centrales, las habilidades y destrezas, porque son claves para generar una vida mejor, pero también porque son un motor económico esencial, porque contribuyen enormemente al crecimiento económico. Y porque los empleadores utilizan las calificaciones que ustedes reciben o que les dan las universidades como una señal clara de la utilidad y de la contribución que puede llegar a ser el trabajador. Sin embargo, comenzamos a tener indicios en los estudios de la OCDE de que la oferta de habilidades de los graduados comienza a no coincidir con la demanda de habilidades del mercado laboral. Y hay un desajuste cuantitativo, por una parte, pero el desajuste que nos está preocupando cada vez más es el desajuste cualitativo, que tiende a ser más significativo. Las organizaciones empresariales expresan cada vez con voces más altas lo que les decía, esta falta de confianza en que los egresados hayan adquirido las habilidades que ellos requieren. Y hay una falta de confianza también, pues, en los mecanismos para decidir cuándo un estudiante es exitoso, cuándo adquiere las habilidades y destrezas. En particular, hay habilidades que no se están percibiendo que se estén transmitiendo y que son tremendamente importantes en la actualidad. Las habilidades genéricas, como la resolución de problemas, la capacidad de comunicación, la capacidad de creatividad, el pensamiento crítico, pero también, como acabamos de ver en el panel anterior de crecimiento sostenible, las habilidades y la conciencia medioambiental, que también es importantísima que permee a los estudiantes y que los estudiantes estén equipados con ese tipo de habilidades. Estas habilidades también nos blindan para todo lo que se viene con el cambio digital y con la automatización de los procesos productivos, porque estas son las habilidades que nos van a proteger de la robotización. En la OCDE tenemos estimado que cerca de un 46% de los trabajos o están en riesgo de ser altamente sustituidos por la automatización o van a ser transformados significativamente por la automatización. Entonces, este tipo de habilidades necesitamos incrementarlas en las universidades y esa sustancia mágica de la que les hablaba debe de tener una dimensión cada vez mayor de este tipo de habilidades. ¿Cómo hacemos para determinar si una universidad está dotando a sus estudiantes de este tipo de habilidades? Y con esto concluyo. La OCDE está haciendo estudios, está tomando iniciativas en las que estamos evaluando los mecanismos más innovadores para determinar si se les está otorgando o no este tipo de habilidades a los estudiantes. Debo de presumir aquí que la UDG fue parte de uno de estos ejercicios y representó a México con las innovaciones que está llevando a cabo para tener esto en cuenta. Yo me detengo ahí. Y...
Muchas gracias. Mario, ahorita que comentabas esto del pensamiento crítico y de las habilidades, pues que les llaman blandas, pero realmente son más power skills, como decía un panelista ayer. Y recordaba ayer también en un muy interesante panel que tuvimos sobre el futuro de la universidad, decía un panelista sobre la importancia de la docencia. Y decía, si la labor de un docente puede ser sustituida por un robot, o por un MOOC, o por YouTube, debe ser sustituido. Es decir, docente que no tenga una práctica o que pueda ser reemplazado por un algoritmo, que lo sea. Y creo que es una lección importante para todos nosotros, la importancia de la pedagogía, de la docencia, para desarrollar estas habilidades. Vamos a intercalar con nuestros ponentes virtuales. Le pido a Dirk, a quien también aprovecho para saludar. Hace algunos años coincidimos ahí en la OCDE, cuando estaban en otro proyecto, el AGELO. Dirk, welcome virtually to our book fair. And please go ahead with your comments.
Okay, well, thank you so much for inviting me, and hello from Europe to our good friends in Mexico, and hello everyone. I will share my screen to just give you a few slides. I want to start with emphasizing and maybe making a case in point about the OECD, because I'm proudly representing the OECD at the moment, even if I'm no longer working for the OECD. I've retired last year, but I'm still attached to the work. Because the OECD has really been pioneering this idea that we have to look at quality of education from a learning outcomes perspective. We have tried over the past 20, 25 years to move the debate in education from inputs to let's look at what the learning outcomes are, what students, what children, what adults learn in educational institutions, and especially those skills that really matter for life. And I won't make a huge long presentation because we have done so many activities. Just a few highlights. You know, of course, PISA. PISA was, when it was first launched in the year 2000, really revolutionary. It was looking at the quality of educational institutions, especially schools, 15-year-olds, through the lens of learning in reading, mathematics, and science. And PISA has revolutionized the view on global education. I think that's not an exaggeration. We have then proceeded to move to the adult workforce with PIAAC, the Program of International Adult International Assessment of Adult Competencies. We have tried to do something similar in higher education with the Assessment of Higher Education Learning Outcomes project, the AHELO project. It was successful in the feasibility study. We didn't succeed to convince countries to move to a main study, which was unfortunate because at the moment in higher education, we still lack the metrics to say something meaningful about quality in terms of what students learn. We have many quality measures, and maybe they are meaningful in themselves, but we don't know actually what students learn and how this learning fits with the demand of society. But we have moved in other fields as well. We have connected learning outcomes and well-being for very young children, the International Early Learning Survey. And we have moved from cognitive skills, reading, math, and science, to a much broader perspective on skills. Because one of the criticisms on PISA was, well, this is very narrow, this is very traditional. This is reading, math, and science. This is a traditional school subject. But what about all the other things that we expect schools to deliver? So we have taken this on, and PISA has now, in every cycle, an innovative domain. It has been focusing on collaborative problem solving, and this year it has focused on creativity. And the publication of the PISA 2020 results at the end of 23 will really be a landmark, because then for the first time we will have internationally comparative data on creativity as a skill learned in schools. We have focused on social emotional learning. That was a project that was very dear to me when I was at the OECD. I have supervised this work. We have been successful in publishing a major book on the development of social emotional learning in OECD countries. And we have been promoting and successfully achieving the CLA Plus International project together with our friends and colleagues from CAE, and I think Doris will go much more into detail on this project. I will just give a few headlines. But this journey of looking at education from a perspective of student learning and the skills that matter for life, what really is important, this has been a very long and fruitful journey. This is a picture from an interesting note on our strategic perspective on education and skills in the directorate of the OECD. And I would like to stress a few elements here, because what we want to do in the OECD is approach learning in a very holistic, a very well-balanced way, looking at many different dimensions of learning. Assessing all the social outcomes, all the socially relevant social outcomes of learning, and making lifelong learning the guiding concept. So having a very comprehensive view of why education is so important. We know it is important, and human capital theory has theorized a lot on the impact of learning and schooling on all kinds of social and economic outcomes. But we have to understand better what education does and maybe does not do sufficiently well in promoting the learning and skills of young people, of adults. I just highlight a couple of books. It's you can say it's a bit of propaganda for the recent work in the Directorate of Education and Skills of the OECD. At the left, you see the book on social-emotional skills, Beyond Academic Learning, a fascinating study. In the middle, you see the Early Learning and Child Wellbeing study, where we pioneered a kind of PISA for five-year-olds. And then the book at the right is the book that interests us now more in particular in this session, Does Higher Education Teach Students to Learn, to Think Critically? A very pioneering event, actually. Why is this so important? Why is it important to focus on assessing the generic skills in higher education? For a number of reasons, and I will not be able to go deep in each of the sentences that is here at this slide. But we think that we move away from a world in which educated employers exclusively look at qualifications. We think that qualifications are losing the signaling value that they had. And actually, employers are interested in skills, are interested in competencies, in what people can do, what people can think. And qualifications are a proxy to that. So generic skills, which are relevant over different fields and different domains of human knowledge, generic skills such as critical thinking are becoming increasingly important in the workplace because the workplace is not organized in terms of mathematics, science, history, geography. The workplace is organized in completely different categories. And you need generic skills such as critical thinking to adequately navigate this reality of the 21st century workplace. There is a looming risk for higher education that what institutions deliver, the degrees, the qualifications, the diplomas, and what the workplace needs becomes disconnected. This is a really very important risk for higher education. Employers are sending signals to higher education institutions that they do not longer automatically trust what higher education delivers to them. Employers say, well, we don't know whether graduates really have the skills that we think are important for the workplace of the 21st century. So we have to focus more on those learning outcomes, but we have to also to focus on the learning outcomes that matter for the outside world, for the workplace, but also for democracy, also for social cohesion and trust in society, also for well-being and the living standards of people. So assessing students' learning outcomes is really a step forward in the very difficult journey to provide more transparency on teaching and learning quality, and to recognize that skills are the new currency and that quality assurance should focus on skills and learning outcomes. The CLA Plus International Project was a major initiative over the past 5 years to develop this, in spite of the failure of AHELO to become a kind of PISA for higher education. So we were successful to have tests of 120,000 students in 6 different countries. And we have worked together with the CAE, and we provided from the OECD the coordination, the platform for meetings, the conferences, etc. So it was a very fruitful new kind of engagement, not a traditional way of working in the OECD, but a kind of innovative experiment. I will not go deep into the results. I just want to highlight this slide because it tells a lot of the very interesting findings. First of all, look at the bars in the 5 countries for which we have data for entering and exiting students. Actually, close to half of the students have not sufficient proficiency in each country in critical thinking skills. But second, there are huge differences. Look at country D, where the proficiency level is much higher. And the third thing that this graph shows is that, yes, higher education makes a difference, but not in all systems, and maybe not to the degree that we want higher education to develop critical thinking. So the progress, the learning gain achieved in those countries is meaningful between the time that students enter and that they leave higher education, but it could be much better. Look at country D again, where the gain is much higher, or compare it with country C. And we deliberately don't mention the names of those countries. Look at country C, where actually there is a slight backward tendency. Less students are able to think critically when they leave the university than at the time that they entered it. But the difference between countries shows that it is possible to use your time in university to develop critical thinking skills. It's not easy. It's a huge educational challenge. And we still don't know the details of how well to develop critical thinking skills, but we are making progress. And we can learn from those examples. And we can learn from also the examples of countries where these developments are not taking place. So, an international cross-cultural comparative assessment of learning outcomes in higher education is feasible. There are still too many people who say, well, universities, we can't compare them with schools. Yeah, PISA is fine for schools, but PISA is nothing for universities. We are all doing the very different things. This is simply untrue. We can perfectly, we have the methodologies, we have the tools, we can perfectly compare universities and university systems in different countries in the skills that matter for life. There is a lot of progress made in the assessment of those skills, also in creativity, also in collaboration, and many other things that people think are impossible to measure. We have valid instruments, and we have reliable instruments, and they work on a cross-cultural basis. Students, when they are in university, they develop critical thinking skills in most countries. But the ambition of higher education should aim higher in all countries, also those countries who do well. The average learning gain is smaller than what society expects, is smaller than what employers think. Because employers think that when a student leaves a university, that he or she is capable to think critically, to do problem solving, to think in a creative way. So the learning gain in those skills that matter are simply too small, and we have a major task ahead in universities to improve that, to make sure that learning happens in those skills that matter, and that we restore trust in higher education institutions and qualifications. So there are ways to move forward. We can do much better, and I hope that the OECD will take this forward together with many partners who are interested in this agenda. Thank you so much for your attention, and sorry to be a little bit over time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dirk. Muchas gracias, Dirk, por tu presentación, por este planteamiento inicial. Por cierto, en este proyecto que presentó Dirk, ya lo decía Mario, la UDG fue una de las instituciones participantes, entonces, lo cual pues, es muy, muy importante. Solo destacaría tres puntos, sí, preocupantes y uno más de entusiasmo de lo que presentó Dirk. O sea, en este estudio de cinco países, universidades de cinco países, más de la mitad de los estudiantes reportaron no tener el nivel básico de pensamiento crítico, lo cual al ratito quiero también que opinen ustedes estudiantes si esto es cierto o cuáles serían sus opiniones al respecto. Pero dos, un poco más grave, que en algunos casos egresan los estudiantes con menos habilidades de pensamiento crítico que cuando entraron a la universidad. Eso me parece difícil de explicar, difícil de racionalizar, pero es lo que muestra el estudio. ¿Qué estamos haciendo en las instituciones o dejando de hacer? Y bueno, tres, las universidades hemos perdido distintos monopolios con el paso del tiempo, de la información, del conocimiento, de la socialización. Quizás el único que nos queda es el de la acreditación. Y lo que nos dice Dirk es que eso también pues está en declive, porque ahora no son la acreditación, o sea, los grados, sino las habilidades. Y en la nota optimista es que la OCDE y otros organismos, pero principalmente la OCDE, está tomando este tema muy en serio y lo está impulsando a nivel global, lo que nos obliga también a la transformación institucional. Gracias, Dirk. Doris, you're next. Muchas gracias. Te cedemos el uso de la voz para que nos puedas hacer tus comentarios. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think I have some slides. Thank you, everybody, for having me here. I'm sorry yo no habla español. That's the only Spanish I really know, other than the words that I hear in New York City regarding food.
Si le pueden poner la presentación, gracias.
But I did want to just say before we get started to thank you to everybody on the panel for having me and for the University of Guadalajara for hosting. I will be discussing some of the results from the report that Dirk was just mentioning. It is 5 years in the making, but realistically more like 10 years of my work, starting with AHALO, the AHALO project. The slides.
Si el equipo técnico nos ayuda con la presentación, las láminas de Doris, por favor.
So the report included several countries, including Mexico, and it was co-edited by Dirk and myself, but we have many, many co-authors that were part of the different various chapters of the report. So if you would like to see the report, it is available online for free, and we can share the link for that.
Doris, if perhaps giving a little bit more time to
make solve
this technical problem, my proposal is if it's possible to continue with a different panelist,
okay.
And then sorry about that,
yes,
but
no, it's fine.
In the meantime, Patty, we can solve this problem. Thanks, Judith, Eaton. If you can give us your perspective, your words. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. And I'm going to be sharing my screen with you. Thank you, and I'm so pleased to be here and join Dirk and Doris and Deb and all of you for this important occasion. I want to pick up in some ways where Dirk ended and talk about aiming higher and talk about the increasing centrality of general skills when it comes to quality. And 3 points. For as long as higher education has been around, we've debated what quality is and struggled with the role of judging generic skills. Yes, they're part of quality, but how and what do we say about them? Quality assurance typically has not made evidence of these skills a priority. I agree with Dirk about that. But I also think, in the spirit of Dirk's phrase, aiming higher, we're in a position, candidly, with or without quality assurance, to move forward with the work of examining generic skills. That is not easy for me to say, having spent 23 years as the founding president of an organization devoted to accreditation and quality assurance. But with regard to the first point about what we mean by quality, we have debated whether quality is about resources, processes, what academicians do, what researchers do. is quality reputation, is quality doing what employers want, or is quality about what happens to students, what they know and can do, or is it some combination of all of these things? But what strikes me is that we have rarely agreed on what counts as quality, with one exception. Throughout all of these debates over the years, no one has fundamentally challenged the importance of having generic skills. And I'm talking about problem solving, I'm talking about communication, creativity, and our general thinking capacity. But even though I think there is a history of agreement about generic skills and their importance, we continue to debate. How significant are these skills to judging quality, and how do we examine for them? This is even more important now than it has been for a very long time, because at least from my perspective, higher education is undergoing a very major transition. We now have multiple higher education providers beyond traditional higher education institutions. I'm thinking of employers, for example. I'm thinking of Coursera or 2U or FutureLearn, for example. We have additional types of credentials. It's not only the degree, it's a certificate. It's the badge that is available, and other types of certifications. And in a number of countries, not all, there is a very public questioning of the value of traditional higher education, the value of the providers, the value of the degrees. Here in the United States, because we do charge tuition, because it keeps going up, and because it is for many families or individuals expensive, a lot of our discussion revolves around return on investment, or the benefits that accrue to higher education when students graduate in debt. So with higher education undergoing this transition, there's a lot of churn. There's a lot of turmoil. And that means to me that the notion of quality is going to be debated more than ever. And it's in this environment, it is this kind of environment that says to me, the work of OECD, what Dirk has done, what Doris has done on assessing generic skills is so important. It's why we need to sustain a HALO and certainly CLA plus. My second point is that quality assurance, with some exceptions, has not made and is still not making evidence of these skills a priority. And in fairness to traditional quality assurance, it wasn't invented to do. It was not invented to hold institutions accountable for generic skills development. It was created to examine how institutions operate their resources and make a judgment from there about whether the institution could produce a quality education. Now, this is still extremely important, but I would argue it's not enough going forward. And again, I'll pick up on Dirk's phrase of aiming higher, if you will. Thirdly, and this I think is a challenge to quality assurance, we will move forward with the work of examining generic skills. Skills are what are wanted as we look around the world, and examinations like CLA Plus do not need to engage quality assurance to achieve their objectives. CLA Plus and other efforts can go forward independently of quality assurance, although it would be desirable to engage with quality assurance. Institutions can move forward without quality assurance. Employers can, governments can, asking for the evidence. And I think that over time, and I think we're starting to see this, employers and governments are likely to focus more and more on the information that CLA Plus provides and less on an institution's or its degrees or its reputation or even its accredited status. And Dirk mentioned this as well, the state of Maryland is no longer requiring the baccalaureate degree, for example, for many jobs. Delta Airlines has moved in a similar direction, and there are other companies that in the U.S. that are doing the same thing. So where does this leave us? I would argue we all benefit from quality assurance, engaging examination of generic skills much more robustly than in the past. I think CLA Plus and the research that HALO led are vital tools to move forward. And candidly, absent some action from national and international quality assurance bodies, quality assurance is going to be left behind in the future of higher education. And in saying that, let me congratulate Deb Adair, who will be speaking to us shortly. Deb is not only president of Quality Matters, she is also the president of the International Network for Quality Assurance Agencies in Higher Education in Quahe. And in Quahe this week, earlier this week, presented its international standards and guidelines for quality assurance in higher education. I was on their webinar, and those standards and guidelines have a clear focus on student learning outcomes and skills. So I'm hoping, Deb, you'll mention some of that. But for me, we need quality assurance to engage and to lead CLA Plus and the work of Dirk and Doris and the earlier work of OECD are all vital to our future. And I'm hoping that we do a great deal to establish a future partnership. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Judith. Muchas gracias. Bueno, una frase en la que estoy totalmente de acuerdo. Aquí hay varios responsables de evaluación y acreditación a nivel de centro universitario, a nivel de la Universidad de Guadalajara en general. Y yo creo que el mensaje es muy claro. Independientemente de los marcos de aseguramiento de la calidad a nivel nacional o internacional, las universidades tenemos que avanzar hacia promover, evaluar, fomentar las habilidades que ya se han mencionado. En este panel. Ayudan los marcos de referencia nacional, sin duda, pero si no los están haciendo, si no lo estamos haciendo como país o como región, ni modo, tenemos que avanzar como instituciones. Mensajes en particular para nuestras responsables que están aquí también. Muchas gracias. Doris, sorry about the technical problem, it's been solved. So, si puedes comenzar, adelante.
Turn?
Your turn.
Okay, thank you. Do I get to advance the slides? Yes. So, before I get started, I wanted to just acknowledge everybody who has worked so hard on this report with me. Our friends at the OECD and the University of Guadalajara, thank you for hosting and for writing your chapter. And then the countries that participated in order of actually time frame, Italy, then Mexico, and with Finland. We have some institutions from Chile within the Latin American group, the UK. That was a very interesting project that was funded by what was then called HEFCE, which is the Higher Education Council for Students. And then very recently, we just had a group from Australia, and then of course, all of our participating universities within the United States. I also want to make note of the group CAPSTAN. CAPSTAN does all of the translations and adaptations for our assessment. They're also the ones that do the adaptation and translation for the PISA exams. So they're the experts in the field, and we have had a decade-long relationship with them. And then, of course, all of my colleagues at CAE, thank you for your contribution and your support. So CAE, you've heard about this organization so far today. We're a nonprofit group, and we originally came out of the RAND Corporation, which is a large think tank. And until 2005, we were part of RAND, and then we became an independent group. And since 2005, we've been working on the Collegiate Learning Assessment, which is an assessment of higher education students, critical thinking and problem-solving skills, as well as written communication. And we refer to these skills today in the talk as generic skills. So up until now, over 800,000 students have been assessed globally, both in 6th through 12th grade, so middle school and secondary institutions, as well as higher ed. And as we've heard so far today, these skills are really important for success, mostly for your own, like as students, because most of the audience today are students. It's for your own sake. You learn content knowledge within the university, and when you leave and you graduate with your degree, you have content knowledge. But unless there's concerted effort to help improve these critical thinking skills, our data are showing that almost half of students who are graduating from universities globally do not have proficiency in these skills. And where can you get these skills unless there's a concerted effort to help improve them? So these are the same skills in the research that my colleagues and I have done, and this is in chapter 7 of the report, that show that proficiency in these skills are predictive of success after university. And this is measured by salary, employment, full-time employment, or enrollment in graduate school. And yet these skills are rarely explicitly taught as part of the university curriculum, and they're hardly ever reported, if ever, on a university transcript. So when you apply for a job and you show the potential hiring group your transcript from university, there will not be a line that says critical thinking proficient. And yet these are the skills that are important. So 60% of the students entering colleges and universities within the US are not proficient. And by the time they graduate, the number drops down to 44%, but that's still a very large number. And that's problematic, because we can do better. As educators in higher education, we can definitely do better. So these are predictive, as I said, and specifically what we measure on CLA Plus are critical thinking and problem solving, as well as written communication. So these essential skills, these generic skills, it's a huge domain. We measure a piece of it, but that piece of it is important, and that piece of it also is able to show that there will lead to, you know, like doing well on these skills shows that there's an association with doing better after you graduate. So what is the CLA Plus? You've heard about it so far. It is a 60-minute performance task plus a 30-minute selective response assessment for a total of 90 minutes. And you are asked to solve a real-world problem. And what's very unique about the assessment is that just like the real world, there's no single correct answer. And because this is a measure of generic skills, you don't have to have any content knowledge of humanities, languages, science, et cetera, to do well on the assessment. We're measuring skills that are above, that are generic, right? And so we give you all of the information that you need, and we're looking to see if you have analysis and problem-solving skills to think critically. This study, which was chapter 4 in the report, was with our colleagues in Finland. So the Finnish Ministry of Education and Culture had a set of students take the assessment, and unfortunately they were not able to complete their exiting students due to COVID. But we did end up doing a very interesting study here where we took the Finnish students' exams and we translated their exams in Finnish into English, and we scored them using our English language scores. And then the Finnish scores, who were bilingual in English, also scored the American students' responses. And we showed that there was a high reliability across the cultures in terms of the languages, meaning that we can do this. This type of assessment internationally is feasible, and we're able to do it in a way that is reliable. This is another, I'm just showing three slides on the highlights from the report. This is the predictive validity study that I mentioned that shows that doing well on the CLA Plus leads to higher outcomes in salary, employment, full-time employment, as well as graduate school. And then the last slide I want to share on the data is related to CLA Plus within the United States. So here we have two graphs. On the left-hand side, we see entering and exiting students' average scores on CLA. And you see that there is a growth. There is a difference between the gray bar, which is the entering students, and the yellow bar, which are the exiting students, for each of the subscores as well as the total score of the CLA. So there's growth, and we are seeing that. We would like to see a bigger difference. We'd like to see the yellow bars be higher than they currently are. On the right-hand side, these are different mastery levels. So emerging and developing, proficient, accomplished, and advanced are the different categories of mastery level for the assessments. And as you can see, the yellow bars are higher in proficient, accomplished, and advanced. And this is also good. So we're seeing that more students, as they graduate, are proficient, accomplished, or advanced in these skills. But we would like to see more. We would like to see a bigger difference. So again, lots of things that the universities and the ministries can do themselves in terms of supporting their student growth, using the assessment, helping develop a curriculum to help improve these skills. The faculty can use this in classrooms. Getting faculty to see the importance of this might be challenging. We understand this, but it is something that's very important, and I think if leadership were to have seminars about this and professional development opportunities to show why these are important, there would be faculty buy-in. And then students themselves. You can use these results to showcase and highlight your proficiency or even beyond in these critical thinking skills to help differentiate yourself when you're looking for a job. So similar conclusions to Dirk, they're essential for academic and career success. We can do this validly and reliably on large scale, globally, internationally, and they are associated with better academic outcomes. So it is essential, this has to be an important component of best practice within higher education. And I just want to leave with this last piece. So this is a case study that I wanted to present, which is a model of how a large public university within the United States, this is Texas A&M University, their Mays Business School, their students were graduating. It's a good school. The students are very qualified. Their students were graduating, and they said, how can we do better? They have high GPAs, but what can we do to increase their critical thinking skills? So we implemented a program with them. We built the program with them where we assessed all of their entering students, and we created a baseline for the skills. And then we introduced to the faculty this whole idea, and they helped review the assessment with the students so they could see their reports and see how they can improve. And then we provided support materials to the faculty to help them teach critical thinking embedded into an introductory course for them. They applied all these skills, and then they were reassessed to see if there was growth. Now, a very, I want to say, cute thing about this study, we assessed, we gave a survey to the students, and we asked them how well they thought that their critical thinking skills were compared to their peers, and like 85% of them said they were better at critical thinking than their peers. And if any of you have any had basic statistics, 85% of the student body can't be better at critical thinking than their peers, right? And so this type of, and then they get their results back and they see, oh, maybe I'm not as good as I thought. Maybe you have this idea that you're really good at critical thinking, but until you actually receive the data and understand and are assessed, you don't know. So any questions or comment, happy to take them later. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Doris. Muchas gracias, Doris. Bueno, por el en aras del tiempo que nos está comiendo, le voy a ceder el uso de la voz a Débora, a Dair, para que nos haga sus comentarios y cerramos esta ronda con Alejandro unos momentos más. Débora, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm delighted to be here. I'm going to start my presentation to help guide my remarks. And let me just say that actually I am, I'm really gonna start and pick up where Judith left off with the idea of higher education in transition, because my comments are about our understanding of quality, especially in practice and quality assurance. So if quality assurance or if quality in higher education is defined as fitness for purpose, then of course we would need to understand what is the purpose for higher education and how that is changing and appears to be changing. So we know that knowledge acquisition doesn't only happen in higher ed, and it never has been that way, that this is the only source of knowledge. But now the options for knowledge acquisition are so great and so varied in both source and type that the value of higher education depends more on its relevance for lifelong learning as it looks today. So some of you may have attended the UNESCO's World Higher Education Conference in Barcelona this summer, and out of that they produced the Roadmap 2030. And it supports this idea of flexible learning pathways and the need for recognition, mobility, and internationalization. And I pulled out an excerpt from that, which says, the evolving landscape of higher education is leading to a greater diversity of academic programs and the need to provide flexible pathways through recognition of all types of learning. So, a traditional way of looking at sort of this lifelong learning continuum is we go to school, we learn, we go to work, maybe have on-the-job training, and then maybe do some add-on additional professional development. So even though it may not be a straight path, it's sort of unidirectional from both age and skill progression. But what we're seeing now is that the lifelong learning continuum today includes many on-ramps and off-ramps to learning. And even if it's somehow still a continuum, if we're thinking about the credential learning that comes out of higher education, there's many ways forward. So formal learning in academic degrees, it's neither or necessarily where students are starting, and certainly not where they're ending their learning. So the new task we have when we think about quality is understanding what being able to take the learning and skills that students bring with them into higher education, those that they may get along the way to a degree, what they learn on and off the job, reskilling via academic environments and non-academic providers, pursuing additional degrees, et cetera. So it is hardly monolithic and supports multiple and intersecting pathways. And because of this, there are numerous quality challenges. So the space is inclusive of both for-credit and non-credit degree pathway, the non-degrees, personal interests, workplace learning, accredited and unaccredited providers. So it's the arena with the greatest variety of educational structures and delivery structures. Basically, it's in some ways can feel almost chaotic at times in terms of where learning can and does occur. And different stakeholders are likely to have different, maybe overlapping, but still different quality concerns at different points in that continuum. So thinking about the job of higher education today or the function of higher education today, one way to think about it is that with all of the on and off ramps to and from a degree, is this really what the future for higher education might look like now, to be able to be to connect the pieces, to be able to recognize and connect relevant, credible learning outcomes regardless of where they come from or how they're achieved. And the big challenge here is knowing what to pay attention to ensure quality for learners and other stakeholders. And in this is where learning outcomes can become a very important currency. So thinking about quality assessment and how it's changing. So increasingly the value of higher education is being questioned, and innovation around societal changes and the demands to demonstrate value is driving diversity in higher education as well as the assessment of it. So the questions that we need to ask is if our assessments and our accreditation processes are also relevant, and are they credible, and do they drive or support student mobility? Does it recognize the diversity in educational delivery, and does it address outcomes? And thank you to you, Judith, for mentioning INQUITY and the international standards and guidelines that we just produced, because that is, in fact, my example here of the idea of one size fits all no longer works. The quality assurance bodies are They are working on this. They're not there yet, I don't think, but to adapt to the changes in ways that make sense for their context. But there is a common need to ensure these values of relevance, credibility, recognition, and outcomes of learning. And so how do we evolve quality assurance to meet that need? So this, as Judah said, we have, INQUA has just released the new international standards and guidelines. And this work actually started with a global study on quality assurance back in 2020, and it has been evolving. So these standards and guidelines are intended to help quality assurance bodies meet the challenges that we're seeing now. So they're an evolution of the previous guidelines for good practice that INQUA had been using for a number of years. And the ISGs, as we call these, are intended to help QA bodies meet the increasing diversity in practices and support the values of higher education. The evolution addresses changing quality assurance mandates and intentions, providing a better focus on relevance, credibility, recognition, and outcomes, and to support a diverse quality assurance practice, right? So there's different quality assurance mandates and structures and purposes. And it's hard to have a one-size-fits-all approach to those things. So this moves away from that kind of one-size-fits-all approach to a customized approach with voluntary modules that focus on the trends that we're actually seeing in higher education today in a way that can help quality assurance bodies improve. So the changes are also intended to help the quality assurance agencies think about and improve their work through three different lenses: one's efficiency, one's relevance, and one is the transformational impact that that quality assurance can have, but arguably may not be having today. So on the question of is it possible to measure not only learning objectives, learning outcomes, but the skills developed in higher education? And here I would say absolutely, and I'm gonna lean on my Quality Matters work here for a minute to this end. So yes, these outcomes and skills in particular are critical for the employability of students, but they're also really, really important in creating a coherent and well-aligned learning experience for students. A course that's designed to ensure that the students can actually know and can do the things that are claimed. Programs that can deliver what they're promising to the students, and institutions that can demonstrate credibility and relevance. So it is these learning objectives and skills are actually critical to a coherent learning experience. And in the last 15 years at Quality Matters, these are things that we have required, and we focus at Quality Matters on online education. We have required learning objectives to be specific and measurable, and of course, skills are a great example of specific and measurable as well, because they are the foundational elements for the alignment of within a course between components, for curriculum alignment between courses, course outcomes and program outcomes, and the demonstration of institutional outcomes for student achievement. Ooh, went a little too fast there, sorry. So let me get ready to wrap up here. We were asked, and the main challenges, by the way, were are why this is hard. Let me go back one more here. Why learning objectives and the move in this direction are challenging in higher education for faculty and administrators are, I can think of three reasons. One is it's philosophical that we, in higher education, we're worried about maintaining and respecting the difference in purpose between higher education and training, and that's one I hear a lot. Our traditional approach is a big factor that our past teaching and learning experiences did not recognize or build from learning objectives. We didn't learn that way. And the third is that this is hard work from an institutional and a faculty perspective to create specific, measurable, and effective learning objectives. So training is needed, but there's a relatively short bridge from the creation of effective learning objectives and the identification and measurement of skills. It certainly, certainly can be done. And actually, we're seeing a lot more activity at Quality Matters in, with instructional designers who are sort of focused on this and moving in this direction. So now I'll wrap up. So one of the questions was whether the paradigm of quality assurance, quality assessment, has come to an impasse because of the economic and pedagogic crises that many higher education institutions have been experiencing now. And I would say I don't see an impasse in this as much as I see sort of habits of thinking that are hard to break. So as much as we can think about quality assurance as a profession and quality assurance as a practice needs to improve, institutions need to engage in it differently too. So when institutions, and here I mean the people in them, think about quality assurance, and especially thinking about accreditation, they are thinking mostly about compliance, right? They're thinking about meeting some quality standards. But a really effective quality assurance practice can push much more strongly beyond that. So because compliance is often seen as the antithesis of innovation, this is why many accreditors, quality assurance bodies are criticized for inhibiting innovation because compliance can be seen as hindering innovative out-of-the-box thinking, and that it can't serve to drive the kinds of changes we want to see. But really, excellence in quality assurance is about a lot more than just compliance. It's about these things on the upper end of this graph. It's about continually improving practices and changing, using data, using your quality evaluation data to actually change and improve practice. It's about demonstrating ROI, meeting internal goals and external expectations, being able to have students who are graduating with demonstrable skills that are meaningful in the workplace. And then doing all this in a way that you can sustain this sort of culture of quality within the institution to drive forward. So it is certainly possible to use quality assurance to make the kind of change we want to see. It's just so often it hasn't happened that way yet. So let me close my remarks there.
Gracias, Deborah. Thank you very much. Bueno, para cerrar con broche de oro esta primera ronda, bueno, realmente ya consumió el tiempo de dos rondas y media, pero bueno, vamos a improvisar. Muy información muy interesante, muy valiosa. Le cedo el uso de la voz antes no agradecer de nuevo, Alejandro, tu presencia aquí, que además de ser decano de la Escuela de Gobierno y Transformación Pública del TEC de Monterrey, pues Alejandro Paré fue secretario de Gobernación de nuestro país, entre otras responsabilidades, también profesor invitado de la Escuela Kennedy de Harvard. Entonces, un honor, Alejandro, una vez más, el que nos acompañes en la fila y en este panel. Adelante.
Al contrario, muchas gracias. La verdad es que el honor es para mí el poder compartir este panel con personas tan destacadas que han dicho ya fundamentalmente, creo, todo lo más importante que tenemos que discutir el día de hoy. Ese es el privilegio también de ser el último en la primera ronda de discusiones, pero voy a subrayar algunos de los puntos que se mencionaron, no sin antes agradecer muy particularmente a la Universidad de Guadalajara por la invitación a este panel y a esta oportunidad. Me parece muy importante que ante lo que estamos es ante el refrendo del valor crucial de la educación para el florecimiento de las personas, pero también para el florecimiento de las sociedades, es decir, sigue siendo la educación, y creo que ese es precisamente el valor esencial que nos tiene aquí juntas y juntos este día, el instrumento por excelencia para que las personas puedan no solamente florecer en términos de su potencial y su destino, sino también para que como sociedades podamos alcanzar propósitos de prosperidad compartida, de acceso a la justicia, de ejercicio pleno de derechos. La pregunta, desde luego, validando esa premisa, es ¿cómo hacemos para que esa educación cumpla su propósito, particularmente en el segmento de educación superior? Y en este segmento de educación superior lo estamos refrendando y tenemos varios ejemplos, expertos y líderes en el impulso para asegurar que podemos medir los resultados de ese proyecto que es la educación superior. Y entonces, pues si no lo medimos, la OCDE lo ha dicho, creo, y lo ha impulsado de una forma ejemplar, si no lo medimos, no lo podemos mejorar. Perfecto, creo que ahí estamos todos y todos de acuerdo y creo que es muy importante subrayarlo, pero empiezan las preguntas, ¿qué debemos de medir? Está bien, por supuesto, competencias transversales, como las llamamos en el Tecnológico de Monterrey, o estos generic skills que se han mencionado también, absolutamente indispensable, desde luego. Pero sí hay una pregunta que conforme vamos avanzando en lo que espero sea un consenso y un impulso y una voluntad sistemática de todos los sectores involucrados en la educación superior para que midamos mejor estas competencias, va a haber preguntas respecto a, muy bien, ¿qué tanto medimos estas competencias generales? O mejor nos vamos a algunas disciplinares, ¿qué tipo de competencias? Y eso, una vez más, nos va a regresar a la pregunta de, pues, depende de qué tipo de segmento de la educación superior estamos hablando, de qué tipo de institución, de qué disciplina, etcétera. En fin, no quiero decir cosas que sean bastante obvias para la audiencia, pero sí creo que vale la pena recordar que incluso desde el propósito de asegurar la adquisición de estas competencias en la educación superior, hay diferencias bien importantes respecto al enfoque de unas instituciones frente a otras y también del enfoque de las autoridades, tanto de las organizaciones multinacionales como desde luego de los propios gobiernos respecto al enfoque. Nos debemos de concentrar mucho en el mercado laboral. Bueno, sí, pero además tenemos que asegurarnos de la educación para la vida. Y creo que lo importante aquí es reconocer estas diferencias y asegurarnos de evaluar las respuestas que tendremos que dar en el contexto de un mundo que está cambiando de una forma incluso, creo yo, difícil de conceptualizar, ya no digamos para la industria de la educación, para las, el segmento de las labores que los que nos dedicamos en educación superior, sea esta privada, no privada, for profit, non for profit, etcétera, sino en términos generales del momento que estamos atravesando en nuestras sociedades. Y creo que hay tres elementos que tenemos que hacernos cargo de que cualquiera que sea la respuesta que le demos a qué queremos medir y para qué queremos la educación superior y qué es lo que queremos mejorar, se tienen que hacer en ese contexto. Estamos viviendo un momento de una transformación mucho más profunda de lo que somos capaces incluso de conceptualizar. No solamente desde el punto de vista del cambio tecnológico, las implicaciones que tiene en materia de inteligencia artificial, cómputo cuántico, el metaverso, etcétera, tiene implicaciones muy profundas. Esto, desde luego, en los mercados laborales, en el impacto en la organización de las economías, e incluso está siendo este cambio tecnológico exponencial y este cambio en los mercados laborales y este cambio en la naturaleza de las actividades económicas, también se está llevando a cabo al mismo tiempo que hay cambios muy importantes, impulsados incluso por el calentamiento global, en términos de dónde se están ubicando las áreas de riesgo en las sociedades, tiene aparejado cambios migratorios y tiene aparejado, creo también, incluso una gran complejidad por la hiperconectividad de las propias sociedades, en términos de cómo fenómenos que ocurren en el otro lado del mundo, pues estamos tan conectados económica, social, políticamente, incluso en términos comunicativos, que también tiene cambios que los hacen los dilemas y los problemas del día de hoy mucho más complejos y nuestras sociedades mucho más inciertas que lo que hubiéramos pensado incluso hace apenas 20 años. Entonces, cualquier impulso para evaluar ciertas competencias y lo que entendemos como calidad de la educación superior tiene que hacerse cargo que vivimos en un mundo sumamente complejo, enfrentado a bandas de incertidumbre en muchos de sus segmentos particularmente los mercados laborales e incluso quién está proveyendo estos bienes públicos que genera la educación superior, mucho más profundos que lo que estábamos hace apenas algunos años y que seguramente se van a hacer más complejos y más inciertos, incluso en el corto plazo. Quiero cerrar esta primera intervención con una reflexión de cuál es el horizonte de tiempo en el que tenemos que pensar para estas labores. Esta complejidad y esta incertidumbre a la que estoy haciendo referencia, este cambio tan profundo, desde luego es muy distinto si lo vemos en una perspectiva de 100 años que si lo vemos en una perspectiva de un año o dos o de un milenio. Pero lo que es indudable es que algo esencial de lo que estamos haciendo en educación superior es que estamos preparando a personas para su tránsito, digamos, de una edad previa a la adulta a su vida adulta. Y entonces el horizonte temporal del que nos tenemos que hacer cargo es precisamente de toda la vida adulta de una persona. ¿Cuál es el esfuerzo que vamos a poner en ese segmento de la educación superior para que durante los siguientes, pues en promedio, 40, 50, 60 años, esta persona se haya llevado de esta experiencia educativa precisamente las habilidades, las competencias y los conocimientos que le van a dar esa capacidad para vivir en ese mundo tan incierto y tan complejo que nos espera? Y déjenme nada más hacer una reflexión de lo que es más probable que vamos a enfrentar estas personas que hoy, como ustedes, jóvenes, están enfrentando en la educación superior, que están en la edad universitaria. Lo más probable es que van a tener muchos más trabajos que los que teníamos en promedio personas de mi generación. Lo más probable es que vayan a cambiar de industria o de sector de la economía mucho más que lo que hacíamos en mi generación o en otras generaciones previas. Pero no solamente ustedes, muy probablemente esto está ocurriendo en muchas generaciones en todo el mundo, muchos trabajos diferentes, muchos sectores de la industria diferentes, probablemente muchos países, muchas regiones, muchos tipos de labores distintas, muchas incluso esquemas de vida familiar, orientación, identidad. Todo eso es probable que cambie, si no individualmente para ustedes, ciertamente en el contexto en el que ustedes se van a mover. Y creo que para que una parte muy importante del esfuerzo que estamos haciendo ahorita y con el que yo coincido y que debemos de impulsar en términos de esta capacidad para medir la efectividad, la calidad de la educación superior y en particular en el contexto de estas habilidades y competencias, tenemos que hacernos cargo de que sean esas competencias las que les preparan a ustedes y a nosotros mismos como responsables de estas oportunidades de servicio a través de las instituciones de educación superior para enfrentar ese mundo de extraordinaria complejidad, de profunda incertidumbre al que nos vamos a enfrentar. En esa medida vamos a ser capaces, sin lugar a dudas, de no solo creo yo, resarcir algunos de los retos inmediatos que nos ha traído la pandemia en términos de reto de aprendizaje y pérdida educativa, etcétera, sino de reinventar en alguna medida también la capacidad de todos los actores que estamos involucrados en el esquema y en el segmento de educación superior, precisamente para que esta sea un atributo, como lo ha sido siempre, pero cada vez más eficaz para generar sociedades más prósperas, más justas, con más acceso a la justicia, con plenitud de derechos para todas y todas las personas. Y creo que es un reto no menor, pero aquí hay un capital intelectual extraordinario que la Universidad de Guadalajara ha podido convocar y desde luego reflejado en el aula, en el auditorio el día de hoy y seguramente entre todas y todos quienes nos escuchan.
Muchas gracias, Alejandro. Bueno, el tema es calidad, pensamiento crítico, habilidades, y uno de los temas fundamentales, una de las prácticas fundamentales para lograr esto es la interacción. Entonces, lo que sigue, voy a salir un poco del protocolo, nos quedan 25 minutos aproximadamente de panel, y quisiera escuchar la voz de ustedes, estudiantes, también profesoras, profesores que están aquí. Si podemos pasar el micrófono para hacer dos, tres preguntas y posteriormente pasar a una ronda de respuesta y posteriormente de un cierre de un minuto de nuestras y nuestros panelistas. Veo manos levantadas, si me acercan el micrófono, si les acerca. Adelante.
Buenas tardes. A mí me gustaría y me inquieta un tanto, ¿cuáles son los retos a los que se están enfrentando las universidades para procurar un acceso igualitario y equitativo sin perder la calidad de la educación?
Les propongo que mencionen las tres preguntas y después hacemos una ronda de respuesta a alguna de ellas o a las tres. Adelante, Ricardo.
Sí, bueno, primero gracias por todas las reflexiones a cada uno de los panelistas. Y yo voy a tocar el tema de la educación como pues, un medio para enseñar a los sujetos a pensar. Y si los enseñamos a pensar críticamente, la visión o la postura que muchas de las veces hemos encontrado en quien tiene el poder de verlos como una amenaza, ¿no? Que la gente piense, y más que piense críticamente, puede ser una amenaza para las personas del poder, ¿no? Los jefes de las empresas, los jefes de los gobiernos. La pregunta es, ¿esto será también una amenaza en el plano del aula, que el docente se sienta amenazado por enseñar a pensar a sus estudiantes? Si los enseño a pensar, me van a cuestionar, me van a preguntar, y pues me voy a sentir ahí vulnerado, ¿no? Entonces, ¿hasta dónde puede ser o no una amenaza y qué podemos hacer al respecto?
Qué provocador, muy bien. ¿Una más? Un estudiante, adelante.
Platicaban de que en estos 100 años, o sea, en este siglo, yo creo que uno de los eventos pues, más importantes que va a haber en estos, del 2000 a 2100, o sea, de los eventos más importantes, comienza desde 2019 pues, al presente, ¿no? De cómo incluso estamos viviendo, pues a lo mejor algunos no lo sabemos a complejidad, pero pues una recesión por allá temas pues, políticos, ¿no? Que no están en nuestras manos. Pero si estamos hablando que va a venir problemas, o sea, que vamos a enfrentar problemas nosotros como jóvenes, a lo mejor si tenemos la tecnología de nuestra mano, o sea, ¿cómo ustedes nos podrían recomendar que nosotros nos acobijemos para estos sucesos que pues, van a pasar, ¿no? En el futuro, que ya están pasando?
Muchas gracias. ¿Una más?
Sí.
Adelante.
Una más. ¿Consideran que la escuela sigue siendo una institución en la que podemos poner nuestro esfuerzo y nuestras expectativas para sacar adelante los retos educativos que la sociedad nos demanda?
O sea, si la escuela solamente, si va a ser, si seguirá siendo relevante la educación formal. Okay. Bien, voy a cambiar el orden de participaciones respecto a esta primera ronda. Doris,
which question should I answer?
The one you want, but in 2 minutes, please. Sorry.
The question about how can we be prepared for jobs that don't exist in the future?
The microphone. Yeah, the microphone.
Oh. The question of how to be prepared for jobs in the future that you don't know about. I think that's the reason why having generic skills is so important. Because content knowledge changes. So what you learn in potentially engineering course now might be obsolete in 20 years. But if you have problem solving and critical thinking skills, they allow you to adapt and grow with the changes of what's to be unknown, right? My husband, for example, this is just an anecdote. He works in a field now that didn't exist when we were in university. He does web optimization of websites to help people buy things online. He works for Coach and Kate Spade and wonderful shoes and purses. But that job that he has now didn't exist when we were in university, and it's because he had these skills that allowed him to think critically and problem solve, in which he's able to adapt. And that's what I would recommend.
Thank you, Doris. Judith, if you can address one or two of the questions in 2 minutes, please. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Just a comment on several of the comments. With regard to equity of access, we're not going to get there absent equity of preparation. And as societies, all of us need to be focused on assuring that we provide that opportunity for preparation. across the board in our countries, whatever your origins, whatever your financial status. At the same time, I think it's realistic to say not everybody is always going to perform at the same level. We're human beings, we're different. What we have to make sure we're doing is not harming one another by our practices and preventing preparation or access. On the provocative question of critical thinking as a threat to teachers, and in my life I have been a university and college faculty member. Part of me says that if you have teachers who are threatened by your critical thinking, we've got a problem with the teacher, all right? I would think that teachers would welcome that. And if one has a sense that one's critical thinking is unwelcome, work with the other students to try to shift that, try to soften that environment. But I would hope that is infrequent, and I realize my solution is not the strongest one that might be out there. With regard to the notion of a shield for what happens in the future, if you're alive, you cannot escape some adversity. That is what being in this world in part involves. The critical issue is to be prepared for adversity, to overcome it, to meet the challenges. And that's a broader way of saying the same thing Doris just said about the importance of generic skills given the variety of jobs and opportunities we all have. Thank you.
Thank you, Judith. Thank you. Great. Alejandro, adelante.
Sí. Me gustó mucho la pregunta sobre y la respuesta de Doris respecto a la pregunta de cómo prepararse para el futuro. Llevamos mucho tiempo como sociedad, particularmente las últimas dos décadas, enfatizando mucho para los jóvenes, particularmente para quienes están en educaciones, en instituciones de educación superior de excelencia como esta, que de alguna manera la hiperconectividad y la tecnología les dan ventajas extraordinarias y oportunidades extraordinarias. Sí, hay algo de eso que es cierto. Y después les decimos, y entonces, pues, tú vas a cambiar el mundo y vas a resolver los grandes problemas. Y no está mal fomentar un poquito de ambición y de visión de largo plazo. Pero además les decimos, ya tienes que tener tu propósito de vida perfectamente claro, porque en esa medida vas a lograr estos resultados con todos estos instrumentos y el privilegio de ser estudiante universitario en un extraordinario lugar. Yo creo que hay que bajarle un poquito a esa presión, porque eso genera mucha ansiedad. Y eso además parte de un parámetro que no se hace cargo de que genuinamente vivimos en un mundo muy complejo, muy incierto, y en el cual, como Doris nos lo acaba de recordar, vamos a enfrentar adversidad. Y creo que las fuentes y el tipo de adversidad que vamos a enfrentar, pues quizá es mayor o es menor, con suerte es menor, pero va a ser distinto al que estamos acostumbrados. Ese es el punto que estoy haciendo. Entonces, ¿yo qué les diría? Ya lo dijo Doris, asegúrense de que tienen bien sus habilidades y competencias genéricas o transversales y que están trabajando en ello, pero sobre todo aléjense de quienes son dogmáticos. El mundo exige pluralismo, el mundo exige humildad. Reconozcan que están en una situación de privilegio, todos tenemos que reconocerlo, porque como bien dijo también Doris, la igualdad y la equidad en el acceso depende de igualdad y equidad en la preparación, y eso lamentablemente estamos lejos de ello. Reconozcan también que esa oportunidad y ese privilegio sí les va a permitir hacer más y sí les va a permitir lograr más, pero no necesariamente y ni de lejos implica que les hace merecer más. Yo no niego que existe el mérito, es decir, que a mayor esfuerzo probablemente debamos de dar mejores resultados, pero eso no quiere decir que nos creamos la idea de merecimiento o de entitlement, la palabra en inglés, de que entonces, como yo ya estudié un título universitario, tengo estas competencias y estas capacidades, merezco decidir y soy mejor, mi opinión, que la de otras personas que probablemente no tienen esas competencias y capacidades. Humildad. un sentido de reconocimiento de la complejidad, capacidad para pedir ayuda. Busquen comunidades en donde se aprecie y se reconozca que el error es ineludible y que es nuestra forma de aprender y de crecer. Y sobre todo, búsquense comunidades en donde el propósito trascienda por mucho el beneficio individual. Que busquen siempre cómo tener una mejor comunidad, un mejor entorno, un mejor país, en el reconocimiento de que lo que nos da valor es precisamente que somos bien diferentes en intenciones, en capacidades, en predisposiciones, y esa diferencia es lo que nos da la oportunidad de aprender y de crecer. Eso nos va a arropar perfectamente bien, particularmente a ustedes que están en un mundo que precisamente por su complejidad también da muchas más oportunidades.
Muchas gracias, Alejandro Paré. Deborah, your thoughts, your comments.
I think you're turning this to me, is that right?
Yes, if you can address one or two of the questions in 2 minutes. Thank you, Deborah.
Okay, so I also, there are a couple that I wanted to address. One was about the friction between quality and accessibility, and the other was about the sense that faculty might actually be threatened by students who can think critically and think for themselves. And I want to put up, I think I forgot to share my screen, so you did not see my slides. There's one slide I want to put up because I think it's indicative of sort of how things are changing. I was, in my remarks, I was talking about sort of a changing paradigm for higher education from being the sole provider of knowledge to being able to recognize, you know, other students who are bringing in knowledge from other places, and sort of being the connector, and about skills and outcomes being sort of the glue that helps stick those things together in credible ways. But the same is true for faculty too. It's another paradigm shift from being the sage on the stage and being the sole source of knowledge, and then being able to think about what students actually already know and bring with them, and how to advance individual students based on where they might be currently in skills and abilities, and where they could grow, right? But that requires us to put students in the center of this, and to be able to measure what people actually know and can do to do that work. But it's a whole shift in what our roles are as an educator and as a higher education institution to move in that direction. Because if our role is now to help students advance from where they are, then accessibility is addressed, right? Because we're because of our knowledge and measurement of skills and objectives, better able to move people to where they need to be. As Judith said, preparation is a piece of this, and acknowledging where that needs to happen. So it's a paradigm shift for everybody, and that's why it's challenging. But I think we're moving in that direction, and I think this idea of being able to measure skills and generic skills effectively is an enormous part of this.
Thank you very much. Mario, ayúdanos abordando alguna de las preguntas. Gracias.
Muchas gracias. Rapidísimamente, en 2 minutos, la pregunta de si los alumnos son peligrosos, si son críticos. Ricardo, excelente dilema. No creo que haya dilema. Por supuesto que sí, y que sean peligrosos. Yo los invito a ser peligrosos, a aprender a cuestionar, aprender a dudar, aprender a preguntar al profesor, ¿por qué esta lista de libros? ¿Cuál es la fuente de lo que me está contando? ¿Cuál es la contrapropuesta de lo que nos está planteando? Háganles el trabajo difícil. Los profesores son magníficos si los alumnos los ayudan. Los alumnos son parte de un proceso orgánico, de una universidad es orgánica. Y los alumnos son las células. y el desarrollo siempre ha sido de abajo para arriba. Entonces, sí, ojalá, yo los invito a que sean, a que cuestionen. Yo nunca tuve el privilegio de crecer con unos padres que no les importaban las calificaciones. Y a veces eso me confundía un poquillo, pero la verdad me pude enfocar más en los temas que me gustaban. Para ellos era importante el entusiasmo que yo le dedicaba a una materia, la pasión con la que me aventaba sobre un tema. Obviamente vivimos en un mundo en donde los departamentos de recursos humanos sí se fijan en el nombre de la universidad y sí se fijan en los títulos, pero yo las personas más inteligentes y felices que he conocido en mi vida no tienen un título. No les recomiendo que dejen mañana la universidad, por supuesto, ¿no? Mientras este sea el juego, pues tenemos que jugar al juego, pero denle importancia también a ser críticos. Esa es mi recomendación. Finalmente, a los policy makers, a los directores, a los rectores, a los coordinadores, les recomiendo pensar más como jardineros que como mecánicos, porque se trata de crear un ambiente en el cual florezcan este tipo de pensamientos, este tipo de cultura estudiantil. Y para eso hay que hacer muchas cosas, como lo que estamos haciendo hoy aquí, debatir, preguntar. Es un campo muy nuevo y lo que estamos haciendo es generar un medio ambiente, un jardín en donde puedan florecer los estudiantes que sean críticos y que esas habilidades les van a dar una capacidad mayor para obtener y para cambiar y para mejorar el mundo.
Gracias, Mario. Decía un profesor que uno de los problemas que tenemos en nuestro sistema, al menos en el caso de México, pero creo que es generalizado, es que durante 6-9 años del sistema básico, la premisa es siéntate y cállate. Y cuando llegan a la universidad, les decimos párate y habla, cuestiona, critica, y pues no estamos acostumbrados a eso. Entonces, parece fundamental esa reflexión. Bueno, nos quedan 6-7 minutos. Nos informaron por chat, por cierto, hace unos segundos que Dirk desafortunadamente tuvo que desconectarse, por eso no le cedí el uso de la voz, pero con mucho gusto nos acompañó 90% del panel. Quisiera pues, tener una ronda final de un minuto, también es parte de la capacidad de síntesis de todas y todos nosotros, con una pregunta de derivada de lo que aquí se ha discutido. Bueno, dos, ¿qué tenemos que hacer las universidades para fomentar todo lo que aquí se ha planteado y qué debemos dejar de hacer? Dos preguntas que realmente pues, dos caras de la misma moneda. ¿Qué recomiendan ustedes como expertas, expertos internacionales, desde un organismo internacional, desde agencias de acreditación, desde una universidad particular, muy importante, que tenemos que hacer las universidades y que tenemos que dejar de hacer para lograr esto? Alejandro, ¿no comienzas? Que te tocó el último en la primera ronda, con el cierre, 1 minute.
Mucho más fácil la primera pregunta que la segunda, pero debemos de medir más y debemos de medir mejor estos resultados, en particular en lo que se refiere a estas habilidades generales o competencias transversales. ¿Por qué debemos de tener estas mediciones? Porque tenemos un montón de decisiones que vamos a enfrentar como casas de educación superior, para las cuales es indispensable que reconozcamos los trade-offs. El trade-off entre formación más disciplinar, es decir, más especialización para ser una ingeniera o un ingeniero, y más formación general en otras áreas. El trade-off entre mayor especialización en educación para el trabajo, mayor especialización o amplitud para educación para la vida. El trade-off justamente al que nos tenemos que enfrentar en términos de calidad de la educación y cómo hacemos para ampliarla y los mecanismos que estamos utilizando para ampliarla. Entonces, es indispensable que esas decisiones las tomemos haciéndonos cargo de los costos y los trade-offs en los que estamos incurriendo. ¿Qué tenemos que dejar de hacer? Voy a regresar con algo que empecé hace un rato, es ponerles todo el costo de la transformación de la humanidad y la salvación de la humanidad a nuestros jóvenes. Tenemos que dejar de hacer eso y tenemos que más bien darles ese espacio, como qué bueno, qué bonita esta alegoría del jardinero frente al mecánico. No tenemos que arreglarlos a ustedes, tenemos que darles un espacio para el crecimiento y tenemos que dejar de querer arreglarlos. Ustedes están a cargo de ustedes mismos.
Excelente, muchas gracias, Alejandro. Deborah, un minuto.
And I think that's for me again, right?
Right.
So I would say I have a very simple answer to this is, as much as we're talking about preparing students better, in this case, to make this change, we need to prepare faculty better in terms of being able to do this work. Doris, I think, talked about at Texas A&M, working with faculty, giving them the tools to be able to integrate these critical skills into the work that they were doing with students. Helping faculty think better about not just skill-based learning, not just critical skills and identifying them, but to think differently about their role in particular and how to better engage with students to create the space and the learning opportunities for this. So I would say what we do is prepare faculty better for the direction we want to go. What do we stop doing? I think we need to stop being, this is easier said than done, stop being so concerned about compliance and start being a lot more concerned about how we're learning from what we're doing and moving that forward. So data is important, but using the data to make positive change is what we need to be doing.
Thank you, Deborah. Mm-hmm. Great. Mario, ¿qué hacemos? ¿Qué dejamos de hacer?
Madre mía, pues muy rápidamente, yo creo que empezar por aceptar que no saben, como lo están haciendo en la UDG, como lo hicieron estas cinco, ¿cuántas universidades? ¿Cuántos casos hubieron en el estudio de la OCDE?
Cinco países
de universidades que dicen, bueno, realmente necesitamos aprender a calificar mejor, a dar mejores señales a los mercados laborales de qué les estamos dando a los estudiantes. Eso es fundamental. Luego, segundo, intercambiar experiencias exitosas entre universidades es también importantísimo, buscar las mejores prácticas. Y algo que yo recomendaría que hicieran menos es pensar que un número puede realmente representar lo que un ser humano es o sabe. O sea, darle un poco menos de importancia a las calificaciones numéricas y tratar de innovar sistemas para decirle al alumno cuánto ha aprendido. Yo los dejaría con una cita y también dentro de las recomendaciones a los institutos, a las instituciones de aprendizaje. Frecuentemente escucho a la gente que me dice, tenemos que preocuparnos por qué mundo le vamos a dejar a nuestros hijos. Y yo diría, mejor vamos a preocuparnos qué hijos le vamos a dejar a este mundo, porque a final de cuentas es lo que va a hacer la diferencia. Eso es lo que...
Muchas gracias, Mario. Judith, please.
Are you asking for me?
Yes, please. One minute.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Well, my do, if you will, is to think other than. We have a habit of sustaining long-standing ways of thinking and approaching life, and that I agree with Deb that involves faculty, but it involves administrators, it involves governments, it involves organizations. So think other than, get uncomfortable, get annoyed, push, but try to look at things from a variety of perspectives you haven't used before. And that takes some discipline on all of our parts, and it takes some risk on all of our parts. My don't is about translation. I believe, and I'm not talking about languages here, I believe that one of our biggest obstacles in higher education is that there's a fresh idea out there, and we say, oh, I like that, but then we translate it back into what we already know. For example, in the United States, I mentioned this earlier, we have all of these new providers of courses and education experiences. And what are we doing in quality assurance? We're trying to look at them as if they're traditional universities. We are translating the new into the old, and we're not getting anywhere. We're, if you will, spinning our wheels. So have what it takes to look skeptically, to think differently, challenge yourself, and don't make yourself comfortable. Stay uncomfortable by translating something fresh and perhaps new into that which continues to give you comfort moving forward. Those are generic skills I'd recommend for managing change in higher education.
Thank you very much, Judith. Doris, te tocó cerrar. You're closing the panel.
Thank you. So as the assessment person here, I have just a short story. When I'm not in a professional context and I go to a cocktail party and people ask me what I do, and I say I make tests for a living, I've literally had people turn their body away from me and walk away because making tests is not a popular thing. So then I started realizing this happened, so I would tell people that I'm like a yoga instructor or a music instructor or whatever, right? So then they would talk to me. But that point is we need to stop making tests punitive. So that's the don't, right? We have to stop this. Like, don't make the test results. Like Mario was saying, these numbers aren't attached to who you are as an identity. Rather, you should take the test results and make decisions about how to improve, should you choose to, on this. And so the takeaway, I think, is that don't assume for universities and for students, both, don't assume you have these skills. Measure. And then use the data to make decision based upon the results. Thank you.
Thank you. Bueno, se nos acabó el tiempo. No me queda más que, bueno, agradecer a nuestros panelistas presenciales, virtuales, al público, a los estudiantes, a las y los profesores, y solo una reflexión, citando una reflexión, retomando lo que decía Alejandro, que me parece importantísimo, del dogmatismo. Y es una cita de un muy buen libro de este analista, escritor norteamericano, Anand Giridharadas, que les recomiendo leer. Dice que uno de los principales problemas en nuestra democracia, en nuestras democracias liberales, es que hemos perdido la capacidad o incluso la fe en que podemos persuadir al otro, en que podemos tratar de convencer al otro. Entonces, cierro eso invitándolos a que no perdamos esta capacidad de pensar que sí somos capaces de persuadir, de convencer, de argumentar, aunque no lo logremos, pero al menos darnos esa oportunidad de persuadir y de ser persuadidos también. Muchas gracias por su atención. Gracias. Vámonos a comer.